presentation will be number 781. 781, Wonderful Story of Love. 781.
We'll do it then. Okay. When you became a Christian, back whenever it was, a year ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 50, however many years it's been, did anything change in your life? Because something should have changed. See, when we were baptized into Christ, as we see on this chart up here, as we go into the water, of course, that's when we die to sin. And if you think death really is a pretty serious break. And in Romans chapter 6, Paul said that that was the point that we died to sin. It wasn't before. It wasn't coming down to the front bench and praying a sinner's prayer and then being baptized a week or 2 weeks later. It is at this point. So has your life changed any since then? Has it changed from anything that it was prior to your conversion? Should your life change once you have become a Christian, once baptized into Christ? And the answer to that is yes. There should be changes to our lives. Because remember, when Jesus came, he didn't come just to be a rebel-rousing philosophical teacher, like a lot of modern people like to look at him. He came with a purpose. He came to save humans from our sins. He came to reconcile us all to God, which poses a question. Think about this. How can we claim that Christ makes a difference in our lives when our lives don't look much different than the rest of society? In other words, how can I claim that I'm a Christian? I go in to the office tomorrow, I go into school, I go into Walmart or wherever, I'm having coffee with my friends, and I say, yeah, I'm a Christian. Oh, by the way, you want to hear the latest dirty joke I heard? How is that going to show a difference? When we preached at a church one time that was real close to a church-affiliated high school, and I went up there and I spoke in chapel a couple of times, but one of the things I heard back was from some of the girls said this, how the boys would get up there in chapel and they'd give these really great talks. They would say some really good prayers. They would lead songs, but then as soon as they got out of chapel, they resorted back to being typical teenage boys. Being crude, sometimes some of them were downright vulgar. See, there's a disconnect between what they were saying and how they were living. And the same disconnect can affect us too. So when we're going out among our friends, we need to make sure that our conduct backs up our talk. And see, we're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. We need to remember as Christians, we are something new before God. We are raised, once we come out of that baptistry, we are raised to walk in a new life. We are dead to that old way of sin. It's behind us. It requires a new way of looking at people when we become a Christian, a new way of looking at creation around us. Does your life reflect this new perspective? That's what we have to remember. When people look at you, do they see Jesus? Reggie White, some of you, if you follow professional football, may remember that name. He was an all-pro defensive end for the Philadelphia Eagles, later the Green Bay Packers. I saw an interview with him once where he said that when people looked at him, he wanted them to see Jesus, not Reggie White. So when people look at you, are they seeing a reflection of what Jesus is like? Or are they seeing just someone who's really crude? Just no different than someone who's not a Christian. Jesus, remember, as we become Christians, we grow in a continual process, growing closer to Christ, growing more Christ-like. And Jesus said that I am the vine. You are the branches. So to be a branch on this vine means that we are united with Christ. We share his life, his history with people who need to hear it. And remember, if we get cut off from that vine, what happens to the branch that gets cut off? It eventually withers and dies. And Jesus wants us to understand, you will bear much fruit if you remain in me and I in you, but apart from me, you can do nothing. See, a person who falls away, a carnal Christian, they can produce some works, but they're not going to be lasting works. And they're not going to be works that really influence people for Jesus. And so today, I want us to start this series, Who Am I Becoming? And think about and look at who we are and what we are becoming. Since God is not someone we can see, the fruit that we produce in Christ is the only tangible evidence that God exists. Now, this material is not unique to me. I found the idea from somebody else, and I just took it and modified it and changed it and worked on it to make it my own product for you. But as we begin this, I want us to look at what Christian love is. Look at the love that God has for us, and do we really have that for one another? Because when we are baptized into Christ and raised to walk that new life, then we need to see things differently. How we love, who we love, and why we love. 1 John chapter 4, beginning in verse 9, if you'll open your Bibles to that or just follow along on the screen. In this, the love of God was manifest toward us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this, the love of God, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love has been perfected in us. So in other words, in plain English, what he's telling us is real Christians need to show our love by actions. In our modern culture, we look at love as being just a feeling, just an emotion. And this is why when people get divorced after 15, 20, 30 years of marriage, well, I just didn't have feelings for him anymore. I just didn't love her anymore. And y'all know last year, I think it was year before, our sitting governor and his wife were divorced after, you know how long they were married? 50 years. I don't know what happened. It's really not important for this discussion, but other than they just decided they didn't love each other. Love needs to be action, and that's what I want us to look at. If you're following along on the outline, let's look at how God modeled true love for us. How did he model it? How did he manage to do it? You see, for Christians, the way we love and the reason we love should change because God modeled true love for us, and throughout Scripture, we see the examples of love that we have from God himself. Even in the Old Testament. A lot of people like to look at the Old and New Testament and say, well, the God over here in the Old Testament is not the same as the New Testament. They're so different. But no, God did say he had a love for Israel. Noah found grace in the eyes of God. So love and grace are prominent and present in the Old Testament. We just have to look at it. And the reason we need to love, remember, is because God modeled love for us. John takes an abstract principle, a vague principle, and makes it personal for us. Because remember, he sent his Son to be the atoning for our sins, to be the sacrifice for our sins. We see in verse 10 here in just a minute, in 1 John chapter 4. And then God's actions is especially remarkable when you look at the fact that we didn't love God first. He gave his Son anyway, even though we really didn't have a love for God that we should have had for God. Excuse me. Loving means initiating an action. And there was no guarantee that God was going to get any return. In fact, most people have rejected God's love. There is going to be no return on that. You're going to try and share the gospel with them. I don't want any of that. That old book of fables there you're reading out of. Oh yeah, well if God loved me, why did such and such happen? God loved us and initiated it, even when there was no return on what he had given us and what he did. And since God loved us with a sacrificial love, we really need to love one another in the same manner. That kind of sacrificial love. Now, you may not have to give and be sacrificial to the extent that Jesus was giving your life. But we still have to put others ahead of ourselves. And sometimes that is going to be sacrifice. Parents, you know what that's about. How much did you sacrifice when you were raising your kids? Things you wanted to do, places you wanted to go, but you couldn't. Why? Because you had a sense of responsibility for your kids and for your spouse, and you had to put them ahead of whatever you were doing. See, and one of the problems we do have when we talk about God is we cannot physically see God. But 1 John 4 even tells us that no one has seen God at any time. He's not in front of us, but there's still a way to know if God is there, and one of those ways is the creation. God has made himself known through the creation, Romans chapter 1 tells us. And let's look at this passage first, and then I'll share an illustration with you. Romans chapter 1, beginning in verse 18, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Because what may be What may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. Now, the them in this case, and the they in Romans chapter 1 is referring to Gentile pagan believer, or Gentile pagans. They're not believers in God yet. Chapter 2, Paul is going to talk to the Jews, and then in chapter 3, he's going to start talking to everybody, Jew and Gentile. That's where he says all have sinned, fall short of the glory of God, is in chapter 3. But now here he says, for since the creation of the world, this invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, and became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of an incorruptible God, or of the incorruptible God, rather, into an image made like corruptible man, birds, and four-footed animals, and creeping things. So what's he telling us here? Well, in Romans chapter 1, we needed a visual aid to help us understand the character of God. Well, the creation itself does not offer the full picture of God. We needed something more, but it does tell us there is a creator. This is what we call a cosmological argument, and it just simply states that because there's a creation, there has to be a creator. The world couldn't just pop up out of nowhere, just like this building. I know it didn't pop up out of nowhere, and I've used that as an illustration before. If I wanted to take the time to know who the architect was and who the contractor was, I could probably find that out. Some of you who've been here long enough might even know who those people were. Or I could go to the courthouse and go dig through archives and find out. Might even be able to, if I wanted to take the time, and if the records still exist, be able to find out who some of the people were that worked on the building. But just this building won't tell me who did all that unless I research it. There is a creation. There is a universe. It's got a definite order to it. The way we rotate around the Earth, around the Sun, the nine planets, eight, I forgot Pluto's not considered a planet anymore. They're there. They all have a pattern. They go around. There had to be a creator for it. Now, I'm on Facebook and social media, and I've got a couple of atheist friends, and one of them, very scientific, and he put on a post, and I forget exactly the wording of it, but the gist of it was that science is closing in on when the universe started, and how nothing or something could come out of nothing. You know, I mean, there was nothing there, no air, no nothing. And I got to thinking about that. Where have I heard that before? I've actually heard it somewhere. That there was absolutely nothing there in time or space, and then something came about. And you know what? And you've heard it too. You know where I read that? Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created, there's the force, the heavens and the earth. There's a point in time. Science and the Bible agree on something. Who knew? There was a time that God, there was nothing there. And by nothing, I mean nothing. There wasn't even any elements. There was no gas, no air, no nitrogen, no nothing. Here's a little trick question that I don't remember what grade it was, but a teacher pulled on me. When you have a bottle here, it looks empty, right? There's actually something in here. There's air. But think of a time when there wasn't even air, no nitrogen, no nothing, absolutely nothing. And God created out of nothing. And if science eventually comes to that point where it says, yeah, the universe at one time, there was absolutely nothing there, and something came, we already knew that. Genesis 1 tells us that God created out of nothing the universe. But we needed Jesus to come and point us toward that God. John 3:16 reminds us that God loved the world, so he gave his only begotten Son. 1 John 4:9 tells us how God revealed his character, by sending Jesus, his only begotten Son. He came into this world to bring us that truth, the grace and truth. And in this, the love of God was manifest toward us. That God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Was manifest. What does that mean? Well, that means to make something that's hidden, take something that's hidden, make it known. It means revealed. Some of your Bibles might say revealed if you've got I think the NIV and New American might say revealed. The King James and the New King James says manifested. It was shown. It was something that had to be revealed to us. Jesus was something visible to the human eye to show God. Now, we can't see Jesus today, but think about the people in that day and time when he was on the earth. They could see him. They could see Jesus, and they could go hear him. Hey, isn't that that guy? Yeah, that is Jesus. I've been hearing about that guy. I want to go over here and see what he has to say. And they could see him, and then they could say, well, wait, who's this guy he's talking to? Oh, that's some guy. I think his name's Bartimaeus. Yeah, that's right. He's blind, isn't he? Yeah, and what's Jesus doing? No, wait, Bartimaeus says he can see. And then while they're going along, and here comes this woman who touches the hem of Jesus' garment. Now, what's that all about? What she think she's doing? Oh, wait a minute. She had a hemorrhage that she'd had for years and spent all her money on doctors who couldn't do anything. She just touched the hem of his garment, and it was cured. Wow. That's something. I want to go and find out some more about this Jesus and go and listen to him. And I want to follow him and know more about him. See, they could see that. They could understand. That was something they could understand. Jesus shows us the type of love God possesses for mankind. The verb tense here, when it says that it was revealed or manifested, points to a definite moment in time. And that was when Jesus was incarnate, or when he came in the flesh, where people could see him. Yeah, that's him sitting over there teaching. Where they could go over and touch him. Yeah, that woman touching the hem of his garment. Or Jesus touching the blind and giving them sight. And then at that point, we could see God's love in human form. See, in this, the love of God was manifest toward us that God has sent. See, God sent Jesus. The word here sent means to send with a purpose or a goal. When Jesus came into the world, it wasn't just because, well, I have nothing else going on. I think I'll go on down there and see what's happening. He had a specific purpose. And we see in verse 9 what that purpose is. He sent them that we might live through him. And this emphasizes what he said in earlier in verse 9. That is why God revealed his love by sending Jesus. So we can live through him and not just exist, but that we can have a life worth living. But I always wonder about how hopeless churches and religious groups are that deny the resurrection or deny there's a heaven. Unitarians don't go for any of that. Atheists don't. What's the point in living then? There is none. But see, in verse 10, we're reminded that God loved us long before we could even consider loving him. And this is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be a propitiation for our sins. We'll see what that is here in just a minute. Remember, God demonstrated his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, and I want to emphasize this, still sinners, Christ died for us. Now, from time to time, I have, and I had this mindset too, that I can't become a Christian. Why not? Well, I've got all these things in my life I need to straighten out. Wait a minute. While we were still sinners, God didn't say, okay, humans, get your act together, then I'll send a Savior. Then I'll save you. In fact, if we just apply the logic test to that. How much sense does it make for us to be perfect before God sends a Savior? Well, the answer is, if we could be perfect and get to heaven on our own, there would be no need to send Jesus. But because we can't, because we were sinners, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, he sent Jesus to take care of our sin problem. God loves sinners, even the worst of sinners. God's love, remember, is unconditional. And that's something to remember. Humans, many times, our love gets conditional. Yeah, as long as you keep being nice to me, I'll be nice to you, I'll love you, as long as you love me. That's not God. God loves everyone. Even when we were unlovable, even the worst of us, Jesus still died for his sins. Now, here's an important point that we do have to remember. God loves everybody, but he does not approve of the actions of sinners. He does not approve of sin. And God hates all the sinful thoughts and actions we do, but he still loves the sinners. I had someone ask me once, where in the Bible does it say that God loves sinners but hates sin? The concept is there. Just think about it. We're sinners. God sent Jesus to save us from our sins. Now we need to change our lives. He hates that sin. He hates adultery. He hates fornication. He hates drunkenness. He hates all that. But he loves the drunkard, the alcoholic. He loves the person maybe who's run off on his wife or her husband. He loves them. He wants them to change. He wants them to come back. He loves the homosexual, but he wants them to come out of that lifestyle. He loves the drug addict who's abusing their body and doing things they have no business doing, but he wants them to come out of that. He does not want to leave them that way. And notice here, verse 10, we looked a minute ago at this word propitiation. That's simply put the remedy for our sins. That's the easiest way I know to explain that. This word was originally in the Greek language, was a word that ancient Greek writers would use of a gift that was offered to deity to make amends for sins or offenses committed against the deity. And that's, if you think about it, that's what Jesus is. He was offered, but God offered him, God sent him to take our place on the cross and appeal and satisfy God's sense of righteousness and justice. God remembers like that coin in your pocket. He's got heads, or the coin has heads. I don't have any coins in my pocket. Oh, well. It has heads on one side, tails on the other. God on one side is righteous and justice, but on this side over here, he's grace and mercy. So how is he going to satisfy both of those? Well, that's where Jesus comes in. Died on the cross, paid the price for our sins. There, the righteousness and justice is satisfied. And now God extends that gift to us. That's the mercy. That's the graciousness of God is extended to us. And then we need to demonstrate God's love to those around us as Christians. We see the model that God has given us, the role model, the example. Now we need to go out and share it. Look at verse 11. If God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. And why did God send Jesus? Well, it's God wants us to take what we were shown and then offer it to others. It's pretty simple. How many of you have known people who've gotten into things like Amway or some other thing like that, and they get all excited about it? They want you to come. How come we don't get that excited about Jesus? We're real happy to talk to people about the ball game, but how come we don't talk to those same people about Jesus when we need to? See, the love of God demonstrates the motive for responding to others properly. Because remember, Jesus said that loving God and loving others can't be separated. In fact, John, a few verses after this section we're looking at, about verse 20, is going to say, how can you say you love God if you hate your brethren? How can you love a God that you can't see at the same time you hate your brother that you can see? See, the two can't be separated. To love one, you've got to love the other. And the logic here is if God so loved us, we ought to love one another with that same manner and same measure that God gave to us. That we go out and we put others' needs ahead of us. That same measure. God put our needs ahead of himself by sending his son. And once we realize that as a result of that love, then we should reevaluate how we look at others. And look at the word ought. Some of your translations might translate it as must. See, it becomes an obligation at that point. And we need to reevaluate others. I knew a guy. In fact, I've known a couple people over the years. Yeah, they could give some pretty good lessons. They could teach a class, very knowledgeable in the scriptures, but they had a little bit of a problem in their personal relationships. In a couple cases I'm thinking of, they had a definite problem with people who had not white, with blacks or Latinos or anybody else. Yeah, I'll share the gospel, one of them said, but after that I won't have anything to do with them. Well, that's not what it says here. It says you need to reevaluate. Think about how you're looking at that. And then as results that we get by showing God's love to others. And really, think about it. If we Christians would live one day, all of us, as if we really believed the Bible, I think the next time we had our scheduled meeting times, there'd be standing room only in all the churches if we would just do that. But look at verse 12. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. Now, this looks a little bit random. Here he's talking about loving one another, and then all of a sudden he says, no one has seen God at any time. Now, if you put it in its proper context, verse 12, that first sentence there, first clause, makes sense. Because the Gnostics were starting to take root with their teaching at that point. And just in simple terms, The Gnostics taught that you could not know God without special knowledge or special revelation. And so John is writing to refute that, that you don't need special visions or special revelation to know God or know who God is, because showing God's love to others is proof, is us showing proof that God exists, because we're living as he wants us. We're following his instructions. We've read the rules, in other words, and we are following as he wants us to. See, when God showed us his love through Jesus, the goal in mind he had is that we learn to love others. Now, I found this picture on the web. This is actually from a church youth group in the Brotherhood. And we like to look at pictures like that and think it's oh so cute and so nice. But this is more of an emotional heart strain. Yeah, it's a great picture. We're not taking away anything from that. But let's remember that it's more than just emotion. Remember a couple of weeks ago when we looked at Nehemiah 7 and 8, chapter 7 and 8? And remember they had been told, that Nehemiah called them all together, the wall is finished, and now we're going to call the roll, essentially. He called out all the children of Israel, and he had Ezra there and the scribes that were reading the law and talking about it and teaching it. And you remember that the people started to get very mournful and very upset because of their sin. And then Ezra said, oh, wait a minute. Today's the Feast of Trumpets. We need to be rejoicing. And they stopped their mourning. Now, did they feel like it? Probably not. But they went to do what God told them to do. Look at verse here back in our text. We see love is not just an emotion. It's an action. I can't command you to be happy or to be sad. Just like Nehemiah and Ezra couldn't tell them to be happy, to feel it. But they could say, let's rejoice. You know, when customers come into my insurance office, there's some customers, quite frankly, we see them coming, we want to lock the door. They're rude. They're obnoxious. But we have this motto about providing remarkable service. Why? Well, because that's what the company wants. That's my job, to be nice and pleasant, even though I really don't feel like it. And that's the way it is with showing God's love. There may be some people you don't particularly care to be around. You know, they just rub you wrong. But God says to put it into action, put his love into action to show them what real love is. And the word perfected here in verse 12 means to bring something to completion, to finish it, to accomplish something. And when we show God's love, when we demonstrate it, and God's love accomplishes its intended purpose, then it's perfected, then it's accomplished. And that is when we show God's love to people, they become Christians, they obey the gospel, they live a fruitful life for Jesus. Next week, we're going to look at how a godly heavenly peace works into us as Christians and how we should have the peace of God dwelling in us. So if who am I becoming as a Christian? My life needs to be changing to reflect Jesus every day, to reflect the love of God to people in a dark world, in a sinful world, people who are torn apart by sin, families that are torn apart by sin. We are the branches. He is the vine. We need to stay connected to that vine in order for us to be able to produce these works and the fruit and the results that God intends. So this morning, are you a part of that vine? Have you been baptized into Christ to have your sins forgiven? If you're not, you need to do that, because that's what just simply doing what the Bible says. Are you the vine, the branch that's attached to the vine? Is the attachment there wearing? Do you need to have it wrapped up? Do you need to be reattached to the vine? That's what we can do to pray for you, to help you be encouraged, to get back in that walk with God if that's what you need. So we'll stand in a moment to sing. If you'd like to come and ask us to pray for you, pray with you, whatever your need is, we'll be glad to do that, or I'll talk to you privately, whichever works. But if you would like to respond publicly, we invite you to do so as we stand and as we sing.
Wonderful story of love.